Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of Critical Care by Richard Dooling, narrated by Richard Ferrone. This work, copyrighted 1992 by Richard Dooling, is recorded by arrangement with the Jean V. Nagar Literary Agency. This recording is copyrighted 1992 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Dr. Peter Werner Ernst, Werner to his friends and Wiener to his staff in the intensive care unit, is a third-year resident at the medical center. 7 years ago, he graduated from the university, and 3 years ago from medical school. But no amount of knowledge, empirical or metaphysical, could have prepared him for the reality of the ninth floor ICU, where now he reigns, every third night, the commander of the death lab. Richard Dooling opens his story with three quotations. From Franz Kafka, "The meaning of life is that it stops." From Nathaniel Hawthorne, "We sometimes congratulate ourselves at the moment of waking from a troubled dream. It may be so the moment after death." And lastly, an old German proverb, "Death is the poor man's doctor." And now, Critical Care.
Chapter 1. Dr. Peter Werner Ernst was the internal medicine resident on call and in charge of deaths occurring at night. Every third night, Werner went without sleep, presiding over the ninth floor intensive care unit from a circular console stacked high with computer terminals and cardiac monitors. At dawn, he worked another regular 12-hour day, then staggered home to bed. During the wee hours of his nights on call, Werner liked to think of the console as the bridge of the Starship Enterprise and himself as, well, not Mr. Sulu. Instead of peering out into deep space or faraway galaxies, Werner was surrounded by 8-windowed pods arranged in an octagon around the console, with a set of automatic glass doors that led to the fire escape and the visitor's lounge. The space fantasy usually wore off about 2 or 3 a.m., and he became just another mad scientist, growing hair on the palms of his hands and the soles of his feet, wearing a white lab coat, surgical scrubs, and running shoes, with a stethoscope around his neck and a beeper tucked inside the drawstring of his surgical pants. He swiveled in his chair at the console and surveyed his mad laboratory of glass pods where the stainless steel railings of hospital beds shone in the gloaming of color TVs. Each pod in the octagonal death lab contained a naked, dying person whose wrists and ankles were strapped to the bed rails with 4-point cotton restraints. Buzzing gadgets, beeping machines, and flashing monitors were strapped, wired, or attached by tubes to the bodies. Fluorescent blips zigzagged across oscilloscopes. Ventilators hissed. Electronic IVs clicked out dosages. High in the corner of each pod, a color TV was mounted on ceiling brackets, tipped forward to provide a perfect angle for viewing from the bed. The hanging televisions were obviously designed by an architect or a hospital administrator who knew almost nothing about ICU patients. When was the last time somebody had seen one of these stiffs sitting up in bed watching a ball game? Instead of their lives flashing before their eyes, these patients died slow deaths listening to American car commercials, the 2.9% financing, the unbelievable buyer protection plans. Werner peered intently at the monitor marked Bed 1 and yawned a gaping, teary-eyed yawn. "Coffee!" he shouted to no one in particular, and 30 seconds later, no one in particular set a styrofoam cup at his elbow. More than anything else, Werner wanted sleep. If sleep were a beverage, he thought, he'd sling a jug of it over the back of his hand and guzzle away until he aspirated on deep draughts and died. If sleep were a dangerous illegal drug, he'd risk prison and degradation just to wallow in it for 8 hours. If sleep were a woman, Werner would sleep with her, but he'd be too tired to please her. A pond, and Werner would dive into sleep and drown. If sleep were anything but downtime for Werner's information processing systems, he'd sleep to excess. After the 24th hour in the 9th floor ICU, a portion of his brain, possibly a gland, did nothing but scream for sleep. Once out of medical school, all he wanted out of life was 12 hours of deep, throbless, uninterrupted slumber. As an undergraduate, he once thought he understood Ode to a Nightingale by John Keats. As a medical resident, he realized the poem was about a physician overcome with sleep lust. Fade far away, dissolve, and quite forget what thou among the leaves hast never known. The weariness, the fever, and the fret here, where men sit and hear each other groan. Where palsy shakes a few sad last gray hairs, where youth grows pale and specter thin and dies. Where but to think is to be full of sorrow and leaden-eyed despairs. Where beauty cannot keep her lustrous eyes, or new love pine at them beyond tomorrow. Werner punched a button on the console and nervously clicked the clicker of a drug company fountain pen in and out a dozen times, while Bed One's cardiac monitor unspooled strips of EKG readings. He pored over the results, fighting brain fatigue and caffeine-induced intestinal distress. An audio monitor picked up some interference and piped a tinny rendition of a beer commercial over the hisses, clicks, and beeps of the life support systems. A nurse approached Werner bearing a sheet of paper, which she wanted to give to him without disturbing him. "I have Bed One's blood gases, Dr. Ernst," she said shyly. As a rule, Werner acknowledged only older veteran nurses who knew their medicine inside and out, or younger nubile ones who made his penis hard. The rest were nondescript wombats, like the creature at his elbow. Feeling sorry for them only distracted him from his work.
"Shall I call respiratory therapy and ask them to increase the oxygen?" she asked, blushing in 4 or 5 shades of pink.
Werner used to squander countless hours every work week just being nice and friendly to the nurses and hospital staff. Before long, he realized that while he was busy being nice and friendly, patients were busy dying all around him. More important, while he was busy being nice and friendly, other young residents were busy poring over journal articles and searching for clues in volumes of the patient's charts from previous admissions. Being nice and friendly to people who weren't sick kept Werner from getting the upper hand on a particularly troublesome case of Legionnaire's disease. Some third-year medical student got there ahead of him. Another time, being nice and friendly to people who weren't sick resulted in a radiology resident nailing down a diagnosis of Goodpasture syndrome after Werner had told the entire medical hierarchy during grand rounds that it was idiopathic pulmonary hemosiderosis. Early in his residency, Werner saw that to be a supernova, to ride the cutting edge in a place like the University Medical Center, an internal medicine resident had to conserve every possible increment of time and energy for the study and conquest of disease. Lower order tasks, such as being nice and friendly, had to be delegated to lower order personnel. if a resident wanted a future at the medical center. He judiciously had to avoid getting into a conversation with someone, like the baggage at his elbow, who could stand in front of a blue patient, hand you lab results confirming your suspicion that every cell in the patient's body was screaming for oxygen, and ask you if you wanted her to call a respiratory therapist to turn up the oxygen. No, Werner said without looking at her. Let's not turn up the oxygen. Let's call down to housekeeping and requisition a big trash bag.
A trash bag?
Marie something whispered hoarsely, her face now burnished crimson by engorged capillaries. Yeah, Werner said, so we can wrap it around Bed One's head and see how long it takes for those funny little squiggles on his cardiac monitor to stop. Werner drained half the cold coffee from the styrofoam cup and tried to stomach the unbearable realization that he wouldn't even be able to steal a nap before his day started over 3 hours from now at 6:30 a.m. He leaned over his paperwork and closed his eyes, an experience more terrifying than falling asleep at the wheel because when his eyes closed, his subconscious burst at the seams. A circus of dream imagery exploding on the back of his eyelids, replaying the day's terrors and emergencies back so vividly that he jolted upright and scanned the monitors to see if he had veered off the road and killed somebody in the ICU. What if the nightmares that were crackling like fireworks on the back of his eyelids started leaking over into his waking moments? Experiments have shown that sleep-deprived subjects eventually start acting out their dreams in real life. What if one sleepless night Werner acted out one of his fondest dreams in the middle of the ICU? Perhaps the dream in which he executes a nurse with a semi-automatic pistol each time she makes a mistake. Or how about the one in which he strangles a patient to death in an effort to save the patient's life? There was no lack of nurses and patients crying out to be strangled and beaten with stainless steel surgical tools. Would the head resident Dr. Marlowe believe him if Werner's story was that he couldn't remember any of it? That it had all occurred during a fugue state or a sleepwalk? A sleep rampage? Would the mugwumps in hospital administration swallow that one? Murder? Werner could protest. She woke me up. Isn't that more like justifiable homicide? Would the med center's insurance still cover him? A different nurse startled Werner out of his chin nap. This one had yellow hair and square copper-tinted glasses and freckled flab where her boobs belonged. Marie is crying, the nurse said. Who's Marie? Werner asked, thinking instantly of the female liver patient in bed 6. You mean the liver in bed 6? No, the nurse said. Marie, bed 1's nurse. Bed 1's nurse is crying, Werner said, as if someone had just told him that trash was blowing across the highway in Waco, Texas. Where's Stella Stanley? Have you seen her? Apprehending that Werner wasn't about to inquire after the cause of Marie's tears, the nurse with the square glasses offered, She's crying because she doesn't like to get yelled at. Werner dumped the last of the cold coffee into his mouth and swished it around to keep the grounds from sticking to his teeth. Oh, Werner said. I see. Someone who doesn't like to get yelled at went to nursing school, of all places. Is this important information? And where is Stella Stanley? Stella! Werner called. A voice came from the half light in bed 3. I already upped bed one's oxygen to 60%. Oh, Werner said. Thank you. Yeah, Stella said. Write the order now before you drop off again. Werner listened to Stella Stanley, RN, doing cranial checks on a semi-alert 83-year-old bowel obstruction in bed three. Hi there, Stella said. Do you know where you are? Yes, the patient assured her. Good, Stella said. Now, can you tell me where you are? I'm not at home, the patient said. I'm somewhere else. Do you know where you are? Stella continued. I'm with you, the woman said. Stella pumped up a blood pressure cuff. Okay, she said. Do you know what day it is? Friday, the patient informed her. Or Saturday. My eggman always comes on Friday, bed three said, and he was just here. But he told me earlier in the week that he wouldn't be able to come until Saturday. It must be Saturday. It's Tuesday, Stella said. But that's okay, don't worry about it. I have trouble remembering what day it is myself. Try this one on for size. Who's the President of the United States? I like Ike, Bed Three said, and so do you. Didn't you tell me that yesterday? I may have, Stella chirruped. But I'm like you, I can't remember. Stella pulled the sheet up to Bed Three's chin. The important thing is that you and I both are playing with a full deck. The cards are shuffled and dealt, and we're ready to bet. I'll be back in with some medication for you in just a little bit. Thank you, honey, Bed Three called after her. Werner spread out the graphs and charts and lab results that together summed up Bed One's condition and tried to rally to the task at hand. Bed One was spraddled belly up under the bright lights. His skin was cyanotic blue and shriveled with age, his torso swabbed and stained orange by disinfectants. A well-ventilated corpse festooned with skin tags and moles and mottled with age spots. Wires, tubes, and lines ran into his remaining accessible veins. A couple of external valves gave easy access to his arteries. A seam of stainless steel staples held his chest together. Most of the space in Bed One's pod was taken up by an intra-aortic balloon pump, bigger than a roll-top desk, with a panoply of dials, switches, screens, and meters that only the intra-aortic balloon pump technician knew how to operate. From the pump's console, large plastic tubes went into the femoral artery on the inner aspect of Bed One's thigh and snaked up below his heart, where an inflatable balloon served as an extra valve. The bellows in the pump beat softly, like the drums of a warlike tribe throbbing in the distance. A few hours ago, the surgeons had had Bed One downstairs. They sawed his sternum open and pried his ribcage apart. Well-paid personnel peered into him from all sides. Their rubber hands and steel instruments rooted around inside him, redid the upholstery inside Bed One's thorax, and shoved his lungs around like piles of cheap pork livers. When the surgeons finished with him, Bed One looked like something out of Mary Shelley's nightmares, blue all over, except for the watercolor disinfectant stains. Bed One bucked the ventilator, a sign that he needed suctioning and pulmonary toilet. A woman in a white lab coat put on rubber gloves. She disconnected bed one from his ventilator and squirted 5 cc of half-normal saline down his endotracheal tube. Bed one gagged and coughed while the woman suctioned secretions from his lungs into a liter sputum trap. "That a boy," she said. "Now we're getting that nasty stuff out of there." The chart said the doctors went in 2 months ago to replace a valve in bed one's heart. A routine procedure, which meant bed one was supposed to wake up afterward. Bed one didn't wake up, resulting in a statistical aberration. When patients didn't wake up afterward, someone had to console the family by telling them that although the risks of complications associated with the procedure were low, every procedure carries risks. Pretty soon, nobody talked about the case without calling their attorney first. The cardiologists speculated that the surgeons shook a clot loose when they were in there, that the clot then went up and lodged somewhere in bed one's brainstem, effectively squeezing off the supply of blood and oxygen to all points north, making mush out of everything above the neck. The surgeons hypothesized that the cardiologists had failed to prescribe enough blood thinners after surgery, causing a clot that would have formed whether bed one had been in surgery or not. The surgeons and the cardiologists agreed that the internal medicine people were at fault for allowing such a high-risk candidate to undergo surgery. Bed one was the thin slice of a pie diagram showing risk and complication in aortic valve replacements. The busy young staff members in the 9th floor ICU didn't give an environmental technician's damn about bed one, because they knew enough about medicine and rudimentary physiology to know that bed one was a slab of warm lunch meat with reflexes and poor vital signs. A life-size figure carved out of spam instead of wax. But they also had a healthy respect for the kind of assault bed one could mount against them. Bed one could make the next 4 hours of their lives miserable just by changing the electrical conduction of his heart and going into a code blue. By simply perishing, he could send the nurses into a shrieking panic worthy of the Weird Sisters. Resignation was the order of the day. Everybody from the nurses on down to the respiratory therapists and the lab techs had already privately agreed that bed one would code sometime tonight, code being short for code blue. Bed one's heart would stop beating, or he would stop breathing, or both. The hospital operator would then announce, "Code blue, 9th floor intensive care unit," 3 times over the hospital's public address system, and a dozen or so specially trained personnel would then descend on bed one, snap bed one's head back, pump bed one's lungs full of oxygen with an ambu bag, inject massive doses of expensive drugs in some of bed one's veins, draw blood for expensive tests from other veins, shock bed one with electricity, beat on bed one's chest, and generally do everything possible to jumpstart bed one, as if bed one were a 57 Chevy that should have been taken to the junkyard 20 years ago. And the doctors and nurses were a bunch of drunk teenagers whose car had broken down on the way to a pig roast. It would go on for hours. It would require more blood, lab, stool, and sputum specimens to be drawn and sent to the lab. Worse yet, everything would have to be scrupulously documented for the legal department. Afterward, there would be witness interviews, probably depositions, just like the ones after the craniotomy in bed 7 had been struck by lightning that came in through the TV set. Bed 1 had no business dying from a simple valve replacement. The lawyers knew that. Because it was 3:30 a.m., Werner was solely responsible for the likes of bed one. All the real doctors and primary physicians had gone home, had barbecued steaks, had watched a few hours of cable TV, and had gone to bed. In his capacity as house officer, Werner had to respond to every medical emergency occurring outside the normal hours of the medical workday, like bed one's dying too soon. "This is what makes it all worthwhile," he said to a wombat at his elbow. "Being able to help people. This is where training pays off." Werner looked the impending medical crisis squarely in the eye and measured himself against it, his self-confidence barely surmounting sleepless anxiety. As usual, he fought the urge to panic by silently reminding himself of his credentials. "I am Dr. Peter Werner Ernst. I graduated at the top of my medical school class. I was editor-in-chief of the university's Journal of Medicine. I am qualified and capable of practicing medicine. I will not panic or succumb to stress and make the wrong decision. That would be irrational and inconsistent with my past performance." Given the hopelessness of bed one's situation, another medical resident might have thrown up his hands and accepted the inevitable descent of the patient. Another resident might have been discouraged by the resignation on the faces of the intensive care unit nurses. Faces that said, "Bed one is about to code, creating shitloads of pointless labor and paperwork for us all." Yes, another resident might have allowed the normal course of human events to degenerate into chaos, death, and a code blue. But not Werner Ernst. Werner was blessed with a superior medical mind, trained in the healing arts. Werner's rigorous training had prepared him for this moment when he, the house officer in charge of the medical center, and the resident physician immediately responsible for the welfare of bed one, would come up with the right combination of medications to drip into bed one. Just the right mix of dosages given at just the right intervals. To keep blood pressure up, keep CO2 down, keep heartbeats passably even, and urine flowing. Keep everything just so for 6 or 7 hours at least, so that bed one would go down the tubes and croak on the day shift, not the night shift. So that Werner could eat and possibly nap tonight, instead of presiding over the death of a corpse. So that the ICU nursing staff could embroider or read romance novels through the wee hours. So that bed one could sleep one last peaceful vegetable sleep before being assaulted by a code blue wrecking crew trying to save his life. And above all, so that all the wicked, ridiculous shit concerning the demise of bed one, who only 2 months ago was a grandpa, a loving husband, and a dad to the people who had brought him here, would come down on bed one's primary physician and the day shift. The day shift had advised bed one and bed one's family that 80 was not too old to try for another valve replacement. 80? Bed one's primary physician, bed one's chest surgeon, and bed one's family made bed one's bed of slaughter and anguish. Why should Werner and the night shift sleep in it? "Hey, Wiener," a male nurse shouted from bed one's pod. Bed One's pulmonary wedge pressure is dropping again. Werner's eyes shifted to phosphorescent green lines squiggling across the screen marked Bed One. "Do we have the first volume of his chart?" Werner asked. "Are there three volumes of four?" "The bottom's falling out of his wedge again," the nurse repeated. "Right. Give him the same thing we gave him the last time he pulled that stunt. And tell him he can't die until he sees the smiling faces of the day shift." Werner paused to reflect that if the medical center were a closed system governed by reason, instead of a wide-open delusional system governed by humans, Bed One's primary physician might have declared Bed One a no-code, in which case Bed One could have died without being molested in his final hour. But as bad luck would have it, Bed One's primary physician was Randolph Hiram Butts, better known as Buttface after he had left the room. Buttface was a hopelessly senile alcoholic, incapable of even basic intellectual and motor skills after lunch. At high noon each day, Butts broke out a hip flask of Johnny Walker Black Label, and by 1 o'clock or so he could be seen cheerfully roaming the hospital corridors, confining himself mainly to the intensive care units, where the patients were so gorked out they would never have noticed the odor of scotch on their attending physician's breath. The State Medical Licensing Board had come after Butts at least twice, but he had outmaneuvered them both times. Before he became a raging drunk, Butts had amassed an impregnable set of credentials and enough political connections to deep six the board's investigations. 40 years ago, Butts had graduated magna cum laude from the Yale Medical School. 20 years ago, before he met Johnny Walker, he had co-authored a book called The Fundamentals of Internal Medicine, which had been updated every 5 years by teams of assistant editors. The text was still used in 2/3 of the nation's medical schools, and it still had Butts's name on it, even though he could no longer balance a checkbook or write a complete sentence. His inability to write also insulated him from medical malpractice suits, because he was the only one who could read his own physician's orders. It meant that the orders he wrote in his patient's charts said whatever his lawyers told him they should say. The more vicious hospital gossips circulated the rumor that Buttface used to wear only Brooks Brothers wingtips, that these days he wore only tasseled slip-ons, and that Mona Washburn, the head nurse over in coronary care, had made him start wearing tasseled slip-ons because she was sick and tired of tying his shoes for him whenever he was too hammered to tie them himself. "Hey, Wienerhead," said another nurse. This one, a short, pushy healthcare commando with a helmet of clipped wire for a hairdo. She slapped a computer printout down at Werner's elbow. "Bed 2's electrolytes, Dr. Wiener Schnitzel, and pretty fucking nasty looking, if you want my opinion." Stella Stanley, RN, better known around the ICU as Stan, was a critical care nurse with 20 years of death, disease, and excretions behind her. The Army had had her in San Francisco for 4 years and had trained her on amputees and burn victims in the Vietnam era. Then she had done 5 years working night shift on a burn unit in Chicago, scrubbing dead skin out of raw third-degree wounds. After 5 years of that, she began to have trouble with her hearing. First, she saw an ear, nose, and throat man. Then she brought suit against the hospital where she worked,
claiming that it was the infernal screaming of burn victims that had caused her hearing to deteriorate. She testified in court that when she used to go home in the mornings and try to sleep, her ears would go on ringing for hours with the screams of her patients until, finally, she was forced to clamber out of bed and drown out the sound with a 12-pack of Budweiser, making the hospital responsible for her hearing loss as well as her alcoholism. Ultimately, she lost the civil suit for damages and had to make do with a workers' compensation award. Shortly thereafter, she came to the medical center and the 9th-floor intensive care unit, which, she insisted, was a Holiday Inn compared with the burn unit. Somewhere along the line, probably Chicago, she had acquired the bedside manner of a mobster, the sound of her voice having all the tenderness of a saw-toothed rectal probe. "How's his potassium, Stan?" Werner asked, referring to one of Bed 2's electrolytes, though his head was still buried in the enigma of Bed 1's chart. "What?" Stella yelled, cupping an ear. "My hearing aid's on the fritz." "I say, how's Bed 2's potassium?" "Oh." Stan took another look at the computer printout of Bed 2's electrolytes. "It depends," she said in a voice so loud that any one of 4 comatose patients might have heard her every word, if they could have only risen for a moment from the dead. She snapped a wad of gum way back in her molars. "It depends on what you want to be when you grow up, Wiener. If you want to be a mortician when you grow up, then I'd say Bed 2's potassium looks pretty good. On the other hand, if you want to be a doctor..." "Thank you, Stanley," Werner said. "That'll be all."
"What?"
"I say thank you."
"Sure thing, chum," said Stella.
"By the by, is it still okay with you if I slam 10 milligrams of morphine into Bed 7 every time he wakes up and starts messing around with his tubes?"
"Yes, Stanley."
"And would you write that in the physician's orders before you leave for your nap?"
Bed 2 had a skin color that would take any other 23-year-old white male a solid 3 weeks of rotisserie tanning in the Bahamas to achieve. Bed 2's solarless tan was caused by toxic waste products, which his kidneys used to filter out of his blood and drip into his bladder, whence the orange poison could be jettisoned at his and his bladder's convenience. Now, all that piss and vinegar was oozing out of Bed 2's skin because his kidneys no longer functioned. His was a deep, dark, all-over tan, which would be the envy of the ICU, except that it meant impending physiological doom.
"Nothing more depressing than a young kidney patient," someone in the report room said.
"Oh, yes, there is," Stella Stanley retorted.
"Cleaning up the loose stools of a young kidney patient is more depressing than a young kidney patient."
Calling Bed 2 a kidney patient was something of a misnomer, because like most kidney patients, Bed 2 didn't have any kidneys. Any doctor devoted to nephrology, the study of kidneys, will tell you that the human body is really nothing but a primitive go-kart containing a simple pump, wires, tubes, cables, a blob of gray matter functioning as a rudimentary battery, 2 gas bags, various units concerned with food processing and reproduction. all nothing but a transport and reproduction mechanism for two highly sophisticated little electrochemical miracles called kidneys. Organs that make the most advanced computers look like clumsy racks of on-off switches. There have been reports of kidney doctors who, as medical residents, were religious non-believers or agnostics until they went into nephrology and began to get an idea of what really goes on inside a kidney. At which point they had mystical experiences and realized that only a divine, all-knowing intelligence could design a kidney. The hair-trigger balance of electrolytes, hormones, poisons, fluids, gases in solution, sugars, and particles trafficking back and forth across membranes in the kidney is beyond mortal comprehension. It has been said that if St. Paul were alive today, he wouldn't have been knocked off his horse by a lightning bolt on his way to Damascus. He would have been a nephrology resident, struck speechless by the awesome complexity of a kidney. Some kidney doctors have gone so far as to leave their practices altogether, becoming TV evangelists who go on the air with anatomical models of kidneys, preaching their message that the way to eternal life is through an understanding of the kidney. Because bed two had no kidneys of his own, every 2 or 3 days, a dialysis technician wheeled a machine into bed two's room. A machine that approximated the myriad functions of bed two's kidneys about as closely as a crystal radio approximated a Bang & Olufsen stereo system. Through a nylon tube that had been permanently installed in bed two's forearm, the dialysis technician siphoned bed two's blood through the man-made Model T kidney, doing the best he could with all the poisons, hormones, and electrolytes. The dialysis machine hadn't done much for bed two's skin color. Neither had the machine done much for bed two's self-esteem or his bridge game. Though one would never know it by looking at him. Bed 2 had recently received his degree in missile systems engineering from the university. He had just been out to Seattle, where he had landed a job with a major aerospace contractor. Bed 2 had flown back home to announce his engagement to the nicest woman anybody in the ICU had ever met. He went to a party and got trashed on piña coladas. He played 9 holes of golf with his best friend. 2 days later, bed two started coughing up blood. 1 day later, his kidneys gave out, and he was shipped to the 9th floor ICU with a diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary hemosiderosis, later changed to good pasture syndrome, a disease that must have received its name from somebody who believed that we all are headed for greener pastures in the next life. Because good pasture syndrome is almost always fatal. The most extreme cure is removal of both kidneys and a life of dialysis 3 times a week. Usually even that does not work. No one knows what causes good pasture syndrome or why it strikes mainly young, healthy males who are inevitably bright, popular, and talented, and who have promising futures. No one knows why a missile systems engineer and groom-to-be should be turned into a kidney patient overnight. It just happens. And when something bad happens, no matter how bad it is, the best thing to do is to make the best of the situation, right? The fact that bed 2 was a terminal orange kidney patient, out of his gourd and tied down in bed with 4-point restraints, was a foregone conclusion. Water under the bridge. Spilled milk. Werner could have sat around, wringing his hands over the legacy of random misfortune for weeks or months. Instead, he was pragmatic. Although every medical person has heard of good pasture syndrome, precious few of them have actually seen it. Bed 2 was a rare opportunity to follow a case of clinical, end-stage good pasture syndrome, and Werner vowed to learn everything he could from Bed 2, before Bed 2 took the far turn in life and headed for the cliff. Besides turning his skin orange, the toxic wastes accumulating in Bed 2's blood also made him crazier than a bedbug in a jar of laughing gas. He had been confused, as is said in chart talk, and in a wild-eyed daze for 3 or 4 days now, and dialysis had not helped any. "Good morning," Stella said, pulling a plastic cap off a large syringe with her teeth and stringing up another IV bottle on a hook over Bed 2's head. "The doctor says that you have to be NPO," Stella explained without looking at him. "That means you can't have any fluids, understand? You can't have any fluids because you don't have any kidneys, so you can't pee. Follow me? But if you like, I can give you some ice chips every so often. Would you like some ice chips now?" Bed 2's mouth opened in dismay at Stella's question. "I don't believe in God anymore," he advised her. Stella spit the plastic syringe cap into the nearest wastebasket. "Hey, Poindexter!" she yelled without turning her head in the direction of the other 7 pods. "What?" came a male nurse's reply from the general vicinity of beds 7 and 8. "Bed 2 doesn't believe in God anymore." "I know," the voice said. "He told me that yesterday when I was doing cranial checks on him." Stella grabbed an orange rubber tube that was sticking out of Bed 2's nose. "I'm going to flush your NG tube," she said, using her right hand to fill a 20cc bulb syringe with normal saline, simultaneously slipping the rubber-tipped prongs of her stethoscope into her ears. "You might feel some gurgling in your stomach." "God was murdered," Bed 2 said. "And I know who did it." "So this God thing," Stella said. "That's pretty offbeat, ain't it? People like you usually turn into believers, not unbelievers." Stella squirted the bulb syringe into the orange tube in Bed 2's nose and listened to the normal saline gurgle deep in the reeds and bulrushes of Bed 2's organs. "God wouldn't answer my prayers with suffering like this," Bed 2 said. Stella clamped off the orange tube and tossed the syringe in the wastebasket. "I don't know," she said. "I've always felt that trouble means that somewhere there is a troublemaker." Chapter 2. 7 years ago, Peter Werner Ernst graduated from the university with a liberal arts degree and went home to read all the books he never had time to read in college. He got a part-time job loading trucks for an overnight mail service and rented a cheap apartment. Convinced that the best things in this world, including sleeping and reading, happened lying down, he furnished the apartment with a bed and a couch. He set out to discover whether it was possible to make a life out of chasing women and reading great books. The significant others in Werner's life had significant other plans.
Beautiful women, parents, even his best friend told Werner to get a job. It was a question of diet and shelter, they argued. Werner found their entreaties objectionable. Every profound sage Werner had read about in college had done a considerable amount of reading and womanizing before doing anything else in life. Socrates, St. Augustine, Voltaire, Ignatius Loyola, James Boswell, Samuel Johnson, Rambo, Valéry, Nietzsche. All those guys spent years reading or debauching before they lifted a finger to feed themselves or take out the trash. Furthermore, Werner had majored in linguistics and the philosophy of language, which meant that whenever somebody said something, Werner had to pause and reflect on the nature of words. Werner tried to get a job as a nice guy with a good education who liked to lie around and read. The liberal arts had thoroughly trained him in the rigors of lying around and reading. His qualifications were in order, and he had a resume to back them up. He beat the pavements and diagrammed the want ads. He chased down every maybe and trod the razor's edge that separated being confidently assertive about one's superior qualifications from being pitifully desperate for some income. The truth was disconcerting. There were no openings for a nice guy with a good education who liked to lie around and read. Those positions all had been filled by other nice guys who had been lying around and reading for so long they had master's degrees and PhDs. Western civilization had degenerated to such an extent that there were absolutely no openings for a Renaissance man with a major in linguistics and a lot of loose science courses lying around. Under increasing pressure from beautiful women who said they wouldn't sleep with him unless he found a job and talked about marriage first, Werner thought out loud about becoming a hunter-gatherer or a Kurdish tribesman. No, the beautiful women said, not a job, a good job. Freud's bones chuckled in his grave when Werner, the Renaissance man, consulted a job counselor at his father's expense to assist him in distinguishing good jobs from jobs. A good job is one that matches your preferences with your abilities, the counselor said. First, you must list your skills and achievements. And then we'll make a list of all the jobs that comprise those skills and achievements. Then we'll simply rank those jobs according to your preferences. How much do people pay for this kind of advice? Werner asked. Werner couched his achievements in the negative. He wasn't an alcoholic. He didn't take drugs. He wasn't violent. He listed two skills. One, falling in love with beautiful women. Two, reading. The session ended when Werner applied for the counselor's job, and the counselor returned half his fee to Werner's father. For a while, beautiful women slept with Werner because he was looking for a good job, and because he swore he wasn't averse to marriage. Werner rose to the occasion of looking for a good job, but winced in the execution. He didn't actually find a good job. Werner's parents had perceived an underlying pattern in the checkerboard of Werner's academic pursuits and were quick to make helpful career suggestions. After all, there were any number of challenging, respectable fields open to a bright, ambitious young college graduate. How about law or medicine, they had suggested. Professions anyone would be proud to wear around. And if neither of those appealed to him, they consoled him with the idea of becoming a doctor or a lawyer. Not wanting to wear out their credibility, they had gone on to suggest that Werner might do worse than becoming a medical specialist or a tax attorney. How about a physician or a barrister? Two perfectly good occupations. In lieu of any of those, Werner's father suggested Werner might try looking into something in the legal field or the medical profession by applying to law school or medical school. Werner selected medicine from the vocational horn of plenty. That September, he became seriously ill, then died and went to medical school. After 4 years of lying around, reading thick science books and taking multiple choice tests, Werner had begun to think that medicine might not be all that bad. The material was not something he would have chosen to read, but after being force-fed on the stuff, he found it mildly interesting. It had a certain internal consistency, as long as one refrained from examining its major premises. And after all, he reasoned, it was a profession for which one was paid well to help relieve the sufferings of others. That was before Werner had spent his first night in the ICU. After a few nights on call, Werner became an unearthly being in suspended animation, a well-trained intellect doomed to walk the linoleum floors of the death labs. Werner's nose flared and quivered slightly, not because any interesting females had arrived on the scene, but because he had just touched a lighted panel switch that opened the automatic doors to the ninth floor ICU. He was preparing himself for the odor. The first time Werner smelled the hospital, his nose told him he was traversing a place of pestilence and evil. That was on the first floor, where even the lobby smells of floor wax, vinyl upholstery, and the gift shop's floral displays couldn't hide the warring hospital odors of antiseptics and decaying human flesh. What was true for the rest of the hospital increased to the power of at least 10 in the ninth floor intensive care unit. The death lab was a clearinghouse for all the odors found everywhere else in the hospital. Werner took a deep breath and tried to make it last as long as possible before he'd be forced to inhale intensive care air. After 30 seconds or so, he took his first breath through the nose, hoping the nasal hairs, turbinates, and mucosae of the nasal fossae would filter out any airborne bacteria before they got to his lungs. The nasal architecture is designed so that a sniff will draw noxious environmental gases only so far as the olfactory region, where the odious fumes may be sampled and expelled before passing farther into the respiratory tract. This assumes, of course, that the organism will have enough common sense to flee the source of the miasma and forever shun the place. But the brain of civilized man has evolved much faster than his nose. Society promised to pay Werner a lot of money someday for cultivating self-discipline and for teaching his brain to suppress the flight stimulus caused by the swamp gas wafting out of these corpses. Werner, the organism, stayed and inhaled the smell of death day in and day out, even though the same smell would have prompted his male ancestors to gather the women and the livestock and migrate to another savanna. Within moments, Werner was acting like a doctor, reading the charts and pulling EKG strips out of the cardiac monitor. He took in the 8 windowed cubicles and observed once again that, although each window had Venetian blinds, to the best of Werner's recollection, the blinds had never been drawn, probably because the half-naked stiffs inside the pods had never regained enough consciousness to request privacy. The staff members preferred to keep the flesh chambers brightly lit 24 hours a day, so the specters within could be viewed at a glance from the central console. Dr. Salami, how's it going? Werner wasn't unhappy to see Stella Stanley, RN, Even though she was only a nurse, she had a lot going for her. For instance, Stella didn't have diabetes, heart disease, rheumatoid arthritis, or emphysema. She wasn't a senior medical officer, nor was she refusing to put out urine. An abysmal day, Werner confessed. Death and chaos with no sex to round it all out. Furthermore, a critical error has come to my attention. Stella took the death and chaos business with a grain of salt. If Werner was still complaining, it meant he was still capable of judgment. Calling the day abysmal also meant the young doctor was still distinguishing one day from the next. Not bad for somebody who never saw the sun rise or set from one day to the next and went without sleep every third night. "You mean bed one?" Stella asked. "Precisely," Werner said, showing her the most recent volume of the chart with a big red one emblazoned on the front and surrounded by allergy warning stickers. "What happened?" "Maybe we gave him too much dopamine," she said. "Don't look at me. I thought he was going to cash his chips in before noon." "Somebody on day shift did this," Werner scowled. "And I'm going to find out who. Aren't they much better staffed to handle this sort of thing on days?" "I concur, Dr. Frankfurter," Stella said. "The day shift is more qualified to process deaths. They're also much better at explaining precisely why someone died. On our shift, patients just up and get it over with unceremoniously, and we don't bother with why." "Family here again tonight?" Werner asked. "The place is crawling with them," said Stella. "And they're mad as hell about only being let in for 10 minutes on the hour." Family was a collective noun used by ICU staff members to designate persons visiting the unit who were neither patients nor healthcare personnel. Family was a euphemism for intruders who had a medically useless, highly emotional concern for patients. They had a tendency to stand underfoot, moping, grieving, and asking inane questions, especially at night. On day shift, the pastoral care program staffed the units with clergymen and clergywomen of all faiths, who in turn enlisted the support of seminarians, deacons, nuns, and chaplains to spend time with sick people and family. The program generated revenue almost instantly, because it allowed doctors to spend more time performing billable procedures. Instead of comforting distraught family members in the visitors' lounge, the doctors could go back to work in the ICUs. But at night, pastoral care shut down and family sought out the medical residents and nurses. Werner looked at his watch and peered down the hallway toward the visitors' lounge. It was time. He could see family coming, moving slowly in stunned clusters like drought-stricken animals on a march to find water. "Here they come," Werner said. "I'll give them your home phone number." Bed One's family showed up at the automatic doors of the ICU. The wife, a squat, round, feeble woman with silver hair and a game leg. The son, a beef-bellied old farmer in cowboy boots, Oshkosh overalls, and a Napa Auto Parts cap. The two of them were old and fat enough for someone to sneak up behind them with stretchers and roll them into their own private pods. Werner hid his head in the charts of bed one. He had told these people a dozen times exactly what they didn't want to hear. "How's he doing?" the old woman asked with a sniffle. Stella went into bed one's pod and removed a thermometer from the patient's armpit. "A little better," she said. He took a bad spin there for a while, but we got his blood pressure back up with some medication, and the doctor has ordered his ventilator set to give him more breaths per minute. He's getting more oxygen than he was before. His color's still not good, though. He put out a tiny bit of urine, which is more than he's put out in days. There's hope, then, the son said, shuffling from one boot to the other and clearing his throat.
He ain't woke up yet?
The old woman asked, rolling with a gimp toward the bed, chapped whorls of red flab wobbling at the posterior of her elbows.
No,
Stella said. He's completely unresponsive. She reached over the bed rails.
Hey, Melvin, squeeze my hand. Can you hear me? Squeeze my hand.
She showed them Bed One's flaccid hand. The old woman started in on a quiet cry.
Name's Elvin, she said. Not Melvin.
The son tried to make himself useful by saying,
Dad, this is Earl. Squeeze the nurse's hand if you can hear us.
Stella went to work, jabbing buttons and setting dials on one of Bed One's IV pumps. Bed One's wife and son lined up on either side of the bed, staring at his chest as it rose and fell with the bellows of the ventilator, wondering why he still had his eyes open if he was in a coma.
How's he doing, Doc?
The son hollered at Werner. Werner looked up from his charting.
His potassium's better, he said.
Say, may we offer you some coffee? Offering coffee to the family was a well-established signal for the nurses to get family out from underfoot and out of the doctor's hair. Marie something promptly answered the bell and led Bed One's family back out to the visitor's lounge. If the coffee gambit failed, Werner had a private backup arrangement with Stella Stanley. If Werner ever said, I'm expecting a phone call, when he was talking with family, Stella promptly went to the med room, activated his beeper, and paged him to the emergency room. Werner wrote the date in the physician's orders of Bed One's chart. He knew the date, but was unsure of the day. Just the reverse of the way things are for the non-medical world. In the business world, most people know the day, but are unsure of the exact date. Furthermore, most people think of themselves as torture victims stretched on a rack with five notches known as weekdays, and they are always acutely aware of just how far the wheel and pinion have to go before they hit the weekend release. What else serves to mark the passage of time, if not a weekend? For Werner, there was no such thing as a weekend, so he never knew what day it was. But the exact date stared him in the face every time he opened a patient's chart and wrote his orders. Werner knew that it was 0200 hours, 2 a.m., and that he would probably be here in the University Medical Center for the next 16 hours without sleep. That, in addition to Bed 1 and Bed 2, there were six other train wrecks to be looked after. That Bed 8's blood sugar was going through the ceiling. That Bed 3 was throwing ominous ventricular beats all over the green grid cardiac monitor marked Bed 3. That if Bed 7's condition deteriorated any further, the Kidney Foundation would be removing Bed 7's kidneys and giving them to Bed 2. That Bed 5 was in severe respiratory distress. That Bed 6 was in severe respiratory distress. That he, Dr. Peter Werner Ernst, was, for the moment at least, solely responsible for their immediate welfare. And that he wished only to go home, crack open a frosty Budweiser, and watch a rerun of Star Trek. Are Bed 4's lungs still clear? Werner asked, clinging to the only good piece of news. Light rals, Stan replied. I think you should up her Lasix and take some fluid out of her. Her wedge pressure is too high. Stan rolled her eyes as Werner went into bed four's pod to have a listen for himself. Bed four contained an 87-year-old white female on the rebound from heart failure and a host of other maladies that once were considered normal for someone pushing 90. She was supine, with pillows wedged under her torso to keep her from rolling around on her curved spine. Her hands were drawn up in front of her like the claws of a dead bird. Her eyes had rolled back halfway into their sockets. Her mouth, which had fallen open, remained permanently ajar. Every now and again she hyperventilated, and the dark hole of her mouth got bigger and smaller. She also groaned every so often, sounding like an exhausted athlete or an abandoned lover. The groans startled Werner because he wasn't used to sounds coming out of his patients. Most of his patients were on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.